Creating CSS animations can be a lot of fun. The possibilities of things you can do are just about endless. That's because of the wide range of options that are available and the ability to use multiple animations at the same time. Let's start by displaying an object. I have a simple page with a single circle displayed on the screen. We can create a simple animation to have it fade in and out. I'm going to just stick to using the WebKit prefix here, but obviously you need to use all of the browser prefixes to get this to work in all browsers. I'll include all the prefixes in my final snippet that you can find on the CSS Snippets website. You define the keyframe with the @keyframes statement. You add the prefix after the @sign. So we need @WebKit-keyframes for WebKit browsers. After that, you need to give your animation a name. I'll call mine Fade In Out. Then we need curly brackets to contain the keyframes. All animations need at least two keyframes, one to define the starting state and one to define the ending state. The timing of the keyframes is defined with percentages. It starts at 0% and ends at 100%. You can have additional keyframes in between, but it's not necessary. So at 0%, we can say we have an opacity of 1, and at 100%, we have an opacity of 0. Each set of keyframes needs its own curly brackets to contain the properties you're setting. The second step is to call the animation. When you use the animation, you need to define two properties. The name, which we defined above, and the duration of the animation. There are many more properties you can add, but this is the bare minimum. I'm going to change this to the shorthand format. I really prefer to use the shorthand because with all the vendor prefixes that are needed, spelling out all the different properties could become very tedious. If I restart the page, we can see the circle fades out once, then remains in view. This is because the default is to only animate one time. If we want the animation to repeat, we can add either a number for the number of times it should repeat, or the word infinite to repeat endlessly. Now, I called this animation Fade In Out, but it really isn't fading in and out. It fades out, then immediately becomes visible again. There are two ways we can make this fade in as well as fade out. The easiest way would be to add the animation direction property and set it to alternate. Normally, an animation will just play forward and then start over. But if we say alternate, it will go forward, then backwards, and then repeat. Another way is to add more keyframes and specify exactly when it should fade in and when it should fade out. You have more control over the timing this way. I could say I want it to fade out by 30%. Then I'll keep it hidden for the next 20%, so until 50%. And finally, I'll bring it back up to full opacity at 100%. I'll take out the alternate as well. Now it's fading in and out, but staying hidden for a moment before it fades back in. Going back to our simple fade in out animation, I want to point out that there's shorthand for 0% and 100%, and that's the words from and to. That really isn't shorter, but it is easier to type, so it can be useful for two keyframe animations. You can animate more than one CSS property at once. Let's create another animation called Shrink Grow that changes the width and height during each keyframe. So I can change the code to use this animation instead. Another property of animation is the timing function, which tells the animation how it should accelerate. The default of this is ease. You can see that it's not shrinking and growing in a linear fashion. We can see the difference if we add the word linear to our animation statement. It's now growing and shrinking at a perfectly even rate. But if we take that out, there's ease happening and it almost appears to bounce a bit. Ease speeds up at the beginning and the end and is slower in the middle. You can also use ease in or ease out to only accelerate at the beginning or end. In general, easing makes the animation feel more natural, but sometimes linear is useful. I'll add a third animation called move that will move the circle around the screen. I'm going to paste this one in. It just changes the position of the circle. With alternate on, we can see the easing even better now. I can remove the alternating so it just repeats endlessly in the same direction. It looks like brackets isn't picking up the change, so I need to refresh this. It's possible to use multiple animations on one item and to list them separated by commas. Each animation can have its own set of properties. I'll make the shrink grow linear and have it alternate. It's taking two rounds of movement for the circle to get back to its original size. That's because this animation is actually taking 4 seconds since it's alternating. If I change it to 1 second, it will only take one revolution or 2 seconds. The ability to combine animations is nice because it allows you to keep your code simpler and more modularized, with each type of animation discrete. You can use these smaller setups as building blocks to build more complex animations. I'll add one final animation called Change that alters the colors. I'll just paste this in and then add a third animation to the circle. One final property I want to mention is the delay property. I can delay everything by typing WebKit animation delay on a separate line. It will then wait 2 seconds to start the animation. If you use the shorthand, the delay must be the second time displayed. The first time in the shorthand must be the duration of the animation. If I delay the color change by 2 seconds, you can see that it doesn't start changing colors until after one full rotation. So this was an almost complete look at how CSS animations work. There are a few more details on some of the animation properties that you might want to explore. I'd encourage you to read the MDN reference on animations, which gives a very clear explanation of all the properties and how they work.